Okay, good morning, everyone. We continue our study this morning of Ashrei. We already had two classes on Ashrei, and Ashrei is such a pivotal prayer that we're going through it nice and slowly to really do our best to understand really every line, to unpackage the meaning that is embedded in every line. I remind you of the statement in the Talmud. The Talmud tells us that whoever says Ashrei correctly 3 times a day is guaranteed a portion in the world to come. So with such a statement, it's worth it to make sure we understand the prayer correctly. I'll remind you one more time of the story that someone once asked me, that what would I say to someone whose son decided not to be religious, but promised their parents that they would say Ashrei 3 times a day, so they'll go to heaven, based on that Talmudic passage I mentioned before. So obviously the answer is that it's not a magic charm. The point is, if you say Ashrei, understand it and live by the values that Ashrei speaks of, that can be a very potent force for the good, ultimately guiding a person to make the right decisions and to live an upstanding life of a Jew. So we are on verse number 7, which reads as follows: Zecha Rav Tuvcha Yabiu. Of the remembrances of your abundant goodness they will speak. So zecher, right, what does the word zachor mean? To remember. So zecher rav tuvcha, we will remember your great kindness. Yabi, we will speak of your great kindness. V'tzidkascha yiranenu, and we will sing your righteousness. So we're talking about a time in the annals of human existence when people will be speaking of God's great kindness and will be singing of His righteousness. Very nice idea. We can only imagine what that must be like for all of humanity to really appreciate the greatness and the kindness of God. The Malbim has a beautiful way of taking this understanding and deepening it even further. The Malbim tells us in source number 2, as follows: Zecha Rav Tuvcha Yabiu, Yasimu Lev Liskur Rav Tuvcha. People will, what does Lahasim Lev mean, right? Sim Lev, what does that mean? To pay attention. I imagine many teachers in Israel use that phrase quite often. Sim Lev literally means place your heart, but contextually means pay attention. People will pay attention to your abundant kindness. Sha'ata Poel Tov, you do good things, God. Ki hanoros he mitzad ha'atava, lo mitzad ha'hara'a. What does the word noraos mean?
Awesome.
Right, that's true. I also think it means like the activities. I think what the Malbim is saying over here is that people will appreciate the activities of God are all for the good and don't come from any evil side. There will be a time when everyone, and this is really a universal passage, when all the people, all the inhabitants of the world will realize Rav Tuvcha, how good you are, God, that everything that stems from you is good. We might perceive it as being bad momentarily, but there will be a time when we will appreciate the goodness. So Zecha, when we recall, we will call Rav Tuvcha, we will recall your goodness, even though when it happened, we perceived it as being evil or bad, but there's a bigger picture. I go back to a mashal that I've used in this class, and I will use it again because I find it so powerful, of somebody who loves tapestries. And they're invited to a museum, and they anticipate seeing a magnificent tapestry. And they go up close, and they are extremely disappointed, because it just looks like strings that are woven together with no semblance of any organization whatsoever. And the person is terribly disappointed. And he, what did I waste my time to come for? And then the docent comes over and he says, sir, you're looking at the wrong side. And he takes him to the other side, the front, and it looks like this magnificent work. So the rabbis explain in a way that this is the way that we perceive this world, that we're on the wrong side of the tapestry. So for us, we see a string here, we see a string there, it doesn't make any sense, and it seems like it adds up to nothing. But this pasuk in Ashrei is speaking of that time, says the Malbim, when it will be clear, Rav Tuvcha, that everything was for the good. It's hard for us to imagine how that can be. We individually and collectively have suffered greatly. But okay, this is the inspirational insight that Ashrei is providing for us. The Malbim continues in the second paragraph of source 2, Vitzidkascha yiranenu, v'az yiranenu berina v'simcha es tzidkasecha. At that point, when we see the tremendous good, so we will praise God with joy for God's righteousness. Umivuar etzlenu, it's clear to us, ki geder hatzedaka hane'emeres etzel Hashem, when we speak about righteousness in the context of God, heim ha'ma'asim she'yaseh shelo. When we speak about tzedakah, we speak about God acting with a graciousness and a kindness, not from a strict sense of justice. Basically, we will appreciate in the end of days how God acts for us with a tremendous amount of kindness. And he's not acting through the attribute of justice and a certain strictness, because we wouldn't be able to maintain ourselves. So there will be a time period in history when we will see everything ultimately was for the good, and we will ultimately appreciate how kind God has been. And that's the takeaway for this verse. Zecher Rav Tuvcha Yabir. We will one day understand Rav Tuvcha, how good God you are, v'tzidkascha yiranenu. And we will sing out about the tzedakah, about the kindness of, I should say, the righteousness of God, not holding us up to a strict measure of justice, of judgment. Because who can stand under such scrutiny? Okay, that's what I wanted to share with you for Pasuk Zayin. So the real judge of the efficacy of this shiur is at mincha time or shachris time, if we're able to remember the insights that we're learning. It's hard because we, Baruch Hashem, have the zechus to learn a great deal of information, and to retain it all is not easy. But if we could just, you know, keep this in back of our mind as we're saying Ashrei, it really could have a very profound effect on our prayers. Okay, moving on to the next verse. Chanun v'rachum Hashem. God, you are chanun. How would you translate the word chanun? You're gracious, right? Merciful. V'rachum, that word is more aligned with mercy. Chanun v'rachum Hashem. God, you're gracious and compassionate. Erech apayim, you are slow to anger. U'gadal chased. That's an interesting phrase that we'll speak of in a little bit. You might be inclined to translate as the Chabad website did, which translates "and of great kindness," but you'll see that it's not a perfect translation. Let's first focus on the initial description. So I've chosen to share with you the Radak, Rav David Kimchi's insights on this verse. So if you look with me in source number 4, Chanun v'rachum, Eile hamidos shehem tov v'tzidka mi'ito. These are the attributes of God that we think about based on the previous verse. Because how did the previous verse end? V'tzidkascha yiranenu, right? God, you are righteous with us, meaning you're not holding us to the strict level of justice. So when we're on that theme, what other attributes do we think about? Again, the previous verse just ended, V'tzidkascha yiranenu. We praise you, God, for your righteousness. So what other ideas are we thinking about? Chanun v'rachum. We're thinking about God that's gracious. We're thinking about God that's compassionate. That's the connection between the verses. We're singing out praise to the Almighty, and we're focusing on His attributes of graciousness and compassion. Eile hamidos shehem tov v'tzedaka mi'ito. These attributes are the attributes of kindness and compassion, yabia v'yironenu, that we speak of, that we praise. Ki hu chanun, God is gracious, shechonen habriyot, God is gracious to the creatures, v'nosin lehem sarcham. God gives the creatures what they need. V'rachum, God is merciful. Shemerachim v'chom el aleihem, God is compassion and kind on the creatures. V'shomer osam men hanezikin, He guards his creatures from damages. U'mafigi ei ha'olam, and that those things which can be harmful in the world. So God, you're very kind. So we speak about praising and singing, and then we give even more description to speak of God's compassion. Erech apayim, God who is slow to anger. Shema'arich apo l'rasha'im v'lo ya'anshe miyad. On this theme that God doesn't hold us to strict justice, what other idea comes to mind? Or what do we just say? Erech apayim, that God is slow to anger. Because somebody who is quick to anger, not in an unreasonable way, meaning some people have a short temper and they, you know, have a short fuse and they blow up without cause. Even when God has cause and he can kind of get angry, even though those are not truly attributes that are shared by God. But even when God is full right to get angry, even though he does have the right, erech apayim, God is slow to anger. God does not punish people miyad. Immediately, and I'm just reminded of a wonderful story I heard from Dr. Pelkovitz, who speaks about Rav Baruch Ber's hat. Have I ever shared this story with you? Rav Baruch Ber was one of the Gedolei Olam in the previous, the earlier part of the 20th century. If I'm not mistaken, he was killed by the Nazis. Hashem Yikom Damam. I believe he was killed by the Nazis. Anyways, he had a famous hat. What was his hat for? So Dr. Pelkovitz used this story in the context of controlling anger. So he says as follows, that every time Rabbi Baruch Ber, I think Rabbi Baruch Ber Lebovitz, if I'm not mistaken, I might be mispronouncing his last name, but anytime he wanted to get very upset, so he made a deal with himself that he's not going to be upset until he's wearing his hat. He used to keep a hat in his closet that he would call his anger hat. And he would allow himself to be furious and to scream in a fit of rage when he was wearing the hat. But if he was not wearing the hat, so he couldn't be upset. Good. So Dr. Velkowitz said, what was the wisdom over here? Every time he was ready to like get to the hat, his anger had already subsided. So that's the trick, right? The trick is you have to learn how to channel your anger, not to dismiss it entirely, but learning how to control it. So for a Baruch Ber, he controlled it with his hat. And by the time he got to the closet to whip out the hat, the anger had already subsided and he was able to be more in control. So in a way, that's a lesson that Rav Baruch Ber and all of us learn from the Ribono Shel Olam. Because God is described as Erech Apayim, slow to anger. And if we want to learn how to be slow to anger, we have to use those tricks, those tools that were modeled for us by Rav Baruch Ber. I thought that was a beautiful idea. You know, if Rav Baruch Ber's closet is like my closet, so when you open it, first of all, the broom falls out, and then all the snow gloves and the paraphernalia from the winter falls out, so it's not even so easy to get to the hat. So I guess my wife keeps the broom there as an Erech HaPayim tool, so that it slows down even the access to the hat. Okay, we don't have a hat, but I think you understand where I'm going. Okay, so let's just focus for a moment or two on the language that David HaMelech uses, U'gedal Chesed. So look what the Radak writes, U'gedal Chesed, Hadalid Nikres Bekamat Chataf, U'gedal Chesed. It's not Godel Chesed. Omar Shehu Godel Chesed, Shemagdil Chasdel Abnei Adam, Yosir Mimashim Ru'uyim Lekabel. That basically God makes his compassion great. Gudal Chesed, God actively makes his compassion great. In what sense? It's far greater than what we deserve. So it's not that his greatness, it's not that his kindness is great. So the Chabad translation is a little bit in the middle. But people would be tempted to translate this phrase as Gadol Chesed, that his kindness is great. That's not the correct translation. The correct translation is that God makes his compassion great, meaning God makes the compassion far greater than what is deserved, far more than what is really coming to us. And again, the connection from where we started and where we are is that there will be a time in history when it will be exceedingly clear how God is entirely good and acted well beyond what we deserve. And in that time period, we will be speaking about specific attributes such as Chanun v'rachum, that God is compassion, God is kind, Erech apayim, God is slow to anger, and God made his kindness greater than what we deserved. So far, so good? I think it really flows very, very beautifully. The Malbim also, and the Malbim makes a similar point. We don't have to look at it inside. Let's move on to the next verse in source number 6. Tov Hashem lakol, God is good to all. V'rachamav al kol ma'asav, and his mercy is on all of his works. So, Nu, how would you translate it? In lieu of what we were saying this morning, what's the train of thought over here? Right? Tov Hashem lakol, God is good to everyone. Who's the everyone? Even Rishayim, right? Even those people who don't deserve it. And we're all Rishayim from that perspective, because we don't deserve the goodness that God bestows upon us. So God is good to everybody. And that's exactly what the Mitzudas David in source number 7 writes, Lakol, Laraim Vilatovim. Those who are, quote unquote, bad, and those who are good. God showers kindness upon us all. And the Malbim echoes those sentiments in source number 8. Tov Hashem lakol, Hashem eino keh. Anyone know what that acronym is? Beis Vav? You get extra points in my marking book if you get that. Hashem eino, God is not like keh, Beis Vav. You're close. Basar v'dam. Basar v'dam. I'll give myself brownie points. Okay. So, Hashem eino kebasar v'dam. God is not like a regular human flesh and blood. Someone comprised of flesh and blood. Shehu tov la'avadav v'kone v'nokem v'sone l'mor dimbo. A regular human being, a king for example, so he's kind to his servants, those who are under his rule, but is vengeful when it comes to those who rebel. Ki Hashem tov lakol af l'rishayim. God is kind to all, even those who are wicked. And we don't just have to think about wicked in the extremes, right? People who are not the upstanding Jews that God wants us to be. I don't want to necessarily use the word Russia, but God provides for all of us well beyond what we deserve. And that's what we're speaking about over here. Tov Hashem lakol, right? V'choshev machashavos lahachzirem b'tshuva. God thinks about ways to bring us closer. V'rachamav al kol masav, and God's kindness extends to all. V'lo yirtza bashchasas b'riyav. God does not want to see his creations destroyed. V'choshev machashavos b'yidach mehem nidach. And God thinks about ways how he can bring us closer and bring us back. Okay, the Ibn Ezra, if you turn the page, I think it's in the back of your first sheet, makes a similar point, and I'm actually belaboring the point, if you will, because I want to contrast this to the Radak. But if you look at the Ibn Ezra, Tov, God is good to everybody, V'chol melech lo yitachin liyoso tov, rak la nashim ma'at. Any king, as amazing as that king may be, can only be good to the people in his kingdom. His reach can extend globally. Rak la nashim ma'at, only to a few people. V'Hashem levado tov l'chol. God is the only one who can be good to all. It's something that we can't fully appreciate or fathom. But every single human creature, every single creature that is fed on this world is fed in the kindness of the Almighty. So God's goodness extends to all. Gam ha-melech le'itachim l'rachim, rak alavadav ha-nehavim. A king can only be compassionate on his servants who he knows and he loves. V'Hashem levad l'rachamav al-kol ma'asav. But God is compassionate to everybody. Beautiful. So if you ask Mitzudas David, you ask the Malbim, or you ask Ibn Ezra, what is this verse going on? They will tell you this verse is a direct continuation of the themes that we are speaking about, that there is a time period in the world when everyone will see the compassion, the kindness, the goodness of the Almighty, and it extends to everybody, from the wicked to the righteous. Good. The Radak, however, understands this verse in a different way, a markedly different way, and I think it's fascinating. The Radak writes in source number 10, listen to this, Tov Hashem lakol, God is good to all. Who are the all that we speak of? Afilu lamine hachayot va'behemot va'ofot. Alternatively read as the chayos, behemos, and ofos. God is good even to, no, to Scruff and to Betsy and to, I don't know, the names of other, common names of other animals. But the bottom line is, right, to animals, to all creatures. V'tov l'Hashem l'kol. God is good to everybody, meaning even the animals, the word chayot and behemot, chayos and behemos, generally refer to animals. Anyone know the difference between chayos and behemos? Good, right. So chayos refer to the undomesticated animals, so everything that runs free and is generally not caged by human beings. And behemos refer to domesticated animals. And ofos refers to the birds. Hu tov u'merachim. So God is good to everybody, not just to human beings, but he provides sustenance for the entire animal kingdom. And then the Radak says something that you and I would nowadays attribute to more liberal, left-winging swings of Judaism. But this is said, and it's not that we don't identify it, but that this type of narrative is usually used in the left. But look what the Radak writes. The Radak writes the bolder words in Source 10. V'chein ro'oi la'adam la'leches b'derachav eileh. It's appropriate for a person to carry on that path. Ve'ein lo la'adam la'hashchis ha'chayim. There's no reason for a human being to destroy anything that God has created for us. Ki im l'tzorech, unless it's necessary. O lishchamir minizikeyem, or to defend yourself from possible danger from these animals or the natural world. So what's the Radak telling us? The Radak is saying we have to support pita. Okay, listen, I'm going to support pita on Yom HaTzmut, but that's a different type of pita. It's a bad joke. Pita. I'm going to support pita, but a different type of pita. Again. What can I tell you? It was a meaty joke. Meaty joke. Okay, I'm going to stop and get back to the potatoes.
If you need food.
Exactly. So listen, this is the Jewish approach, but I think it's a beautiful one, that if God has mercy and compassion on the animal kingdom, Tov Hashem Lakol, so we too have to mimic the way that God has set out for us. So we have to be kind and considerate for the natural world that surrounds us. But where I think the Jewish approach differs from different narratives that are going on nowadays in the social movements is that exactly what the Radak writes, that we have to be careful, considerate, kind. But we also understand that God provided these animals and the natural world for our benefit. And that's what the Radak writes. We don't destroy unnecessarily, but if there's a tzorech, if there's a need, we're allowed to consume and to use. So, for example, we're allowed to eat meat. If there's a need for our own sustenance, for our own nutrients, for our own enjoyment and pleasure, that would be permitted.
What about the fur to keep warm? Is that
so? I think that would be okay. I don't see a problem with that. Certainly, if you're going to be using the meat of the animal anyways for human consumption, so to also use the hides for like a fur coat, I don't have any issue with that. This is recorded, so I'm going to be now labeled as some right wing extremist. But I think that this is very much the balanced Jewish approach, that we absolutely remain devoted to the natural world that surrounds us, to the animal world that surrounds us, and we have to do our part, not only not to destroy, but to protect and preserve, right? What was Hashem's words to Adam in Gan Eden? L'ovda u'lishomra. That there's a need to work the land, to cultivate it, but also to guard it. That's the Jewish approach. But it's balanced, not to the extreme where, animals rule the day over humans. That doesn't make sense. Or alternatively, as the Radak says, we are mandated to guard ourselves. So if there are dangerous natural forces, if there are dangerous animals, and we either need to, exterminate the animal or to protect ourselves in another fashion, Judaism espouses such an approach. So I was intrigued by the Radak really for two reasons. First of all, he understands the verse so different from the other commentaries, right? The other commentaries focus on Tov L'Hashem L'Kol, V'Rachamav L'Kol Masav, talking about the Rishaim, And the Radak says, no, this is a verse talking about animals, that God's compassion and God's kindness extends even over the animal kingdom. So I think that that by itself is very interesting, worthy to take note of, point A. And point B, it's just interesting to see how the Rishonim were certainly very concerned and sensitive to the natural world that surrounds us, but of course within a certain degree of reason and moderation. Right, so I think that the hunting for hunting's sake, I think is fraught with halachic issues. Baal Tashchis is an issue mentioned in the Torah itself, as I'm sure you're familiar, but it has its limits, right? We're not allowed to cut down fruit-bearing trees. That's actually the context in the Torah. The Torah says, when you lay siege to a city, you can't cut down its fruit-bearing trees, because why should the tree suffer because of your siege? But if you learn the topic, which I'm not about to give a class on, you see, it's not absolute, meaning if there's a purpose for cutting down the tree, if it's going to, I believe, if it's going to help you conquer the city in a more effective manner, then it would be permitted. So Judaism, I think, espouses a very moderate, balanced approach to you know, conservation, so on and so forth. But I was tickled to see the words of the Radak reflecting those ideas. He quotes an interesting Gemara. The Gemara in Bava Metzia reads as follows: V'chi matzinu. So I'm in source number 10, line number 3. This is a Gemara in Bava Metzia. Ki Rabbeinu HaKadosh. Anyone know who that's a reference to? When we speak of Rabbeinu HaKadosh. You need me?
It's very important.
Okay. Just told. No problem. Sorry, just coordinating with the mayor joining us this evening. He cleared his whole schedule just to be here, so, yeah. Okay, so the Radak quotes from this Gemara. Who's Rabbeinu HaKadosh? Other opportunities for brownie points here this morning. Rabbeinu HaKadosh is always a reference to Rabbeinu Yehuda Hanasi, Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi. Rabbi Judah the Prince, the editor of the Mishnah. So the Gemara records a story regarding Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi. He's here Shiv Chaso, who once warned might be a strong word, who once encouraged his maidservant, Shelo le'asof hacholdos haketanos im doman habayis. Something along the lines of like not, what's a cholda? A weasel, I think, right? So basically, the maidservant was like shooing the weasels out of the house and was being a little bit aggressive. I don't know the exact context of the story. And Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi said, "Tinachem lihios darim be'akire habayis." Let them stay in the bottom of the house. Meaning, I don't think they were welcomed in the main living quarters, but let them stay in the bottom of the house. And Amar Lav, when he was speaking to his maidservant about this topic, you know what language he used? What verse did he invoke? Amar Lav, v'rachamav al kol ma'asav k'siv. He said, my dear maid, you have to be kind even to the weasels, because after all, we know in Ashrei it says, v'rachamav al kol ma'asav, that God has compassion for all of his creatures. Now, next time my wife tells me to kill a fly or a moth, I'm going to say, honey, v'rachamav al kol ma'asav. And she's going to say, honey, you kill it or you get out. So I'm going to kill it. But
my father-in-law used to place a glass over it.
Right. A paper. And then, yeah, exactly. Or... Exactly. Yeah, we try to do that also. But sometimes, you know, the little guys don't allow you to do such kind things. But to the extent that we can be kind, v'rachamav al kol ma'asav. God is known as having compassion on all of his creatures.
But yeah. When you have things like mosquitoes and you have things like hornets and wasps, yeah, I mean, you
want to kill them. And I think that falls under the what Radak said earlier, that we have to be careful unless we are using it for our benefit or guarding against damage. So if there are insects that can really hurt us, so I think those are the types of things that we just have to get rid of in the most efficient way so they don't damage us. But conceptually, as much as we can be kind and can limit the damage, So that's a very important idea. Yes, was there a question? No. Okay, so let's move on now to the next verse. Yoducha Hashem kol ma'asecha, that all your works will thank you. This is verse 10. V'chasidecha yivarchucha, and your pious ones will bless you. So again, very much thematically related, that we are in this time period when everyone will see the goodness of God, the greatness of God, the compassion of God, and everybody will give thanks and bless you. So there's yaducha, to give thanks, and also yivarchucha, to give blessing. Radak writes in source number 12, Yoducha af mine hachayim she'en bahem das, even these living creatures that don't have knowledge, mitikun yitzirascha bahen, you provide for them, v'hachanas mizonoseihem, and you provide their sustenance, Yoducha ha'adam ha'mevim bahem. When human beings see the greatness of God, that God provides even for the animal creatures, so it deepens our appreciation. So it's not saying that the lions are necessarily going to start roaring in thanks to the Almighty, although I think there are some other biblical verses that speak of even the animals, right? We say in Lecha Dodi, Heharim v'hagvaos yiftzichu lefnei chamrina, right? V'chalatzei asada yimchau chaf. We speak of times when even the natural world will give thanks to the Almighty. But I don't think that that's really what was going. That's going on right here. What the Radak is saying is that when we see how God provides for the animals, that deepens our appreciation and that deepens our thanks. So by looking at the natural world, it enhances our feelings of thanks to the Almighty. V'hareihem ki'ilu yaducha. It's as if the animals are giving thanks, but it's not really the animals. Who is giving the thanks? It's we are. Because we see how magnificent and how kind God is. V'chasidecha yivarchucha, and the pious ones will also bless you. Right? Ki b'chol eis ra'osam ha'chidushim ha'mischadshim tami b'yitzuram. The pious ones see how you're constantly renewing and giving more and more blessing. V'hitkin v'hatikon asher bohem, and everything is so orderly in the natural world. B'chai v'tzomeach yivarchucha, and everything that grows, and it just prompts us to give more and more thanks. V'chein tiknu razal, and that's why our rabbis have instituted bracha l'chol davar kifi inyano. We bless everything as we see it. Kemosha amru haroa kach lekach mevarich kach. You look at the Gemara brachos towards the end; it lists a whole slew of brachos. You see this, you say a bracha. You see that, you say a bracha. Thunder, lightning, there, everything you say brachos for. Because when we see the natural world that surrounds us, it prompts us to give blessing and thanks for the almighty works of the creation.
So it's just creature, living things, or it could be like the sun and the moon. And
you're right. So we have to know which. You have to know what you are supposed to say a bracha on. I mean, it would be inappropriate for someone to make the bracha on thunder when they see the sun. But there, yeah,
we're thankful for all those.
Yeah, absolutely. And you can always say Magadlu Masecha Hashem, right? How grand are your creations, Almighty? The Malbim has a little bit of a different take. The Malbim in source number 13 writes Yoducha Hashem Kol Masecha. We will realize in this time period when everyone's thanking God, how everything God has done has been for the good. That God has watched us to ensure that we live, and has ordered everything correctly. There's nothing bad coming from God. And this is in line with the way we started and the inside of the Malbim, right? Remember, we said that there will be a time period, as the Malbim explained, there will be a time period when we realize that it's all tuvcha, that it's all good, that everything that comes from God, even though we don't appreciate it in this world, there will be a way that it's explained, and we will see the goodness embedded in it. And that's the same idea that the Malbim refers to over here. Yoducha Hashem kol masecha. The time will come when we will give thanks, God, for all of your workings, for all of your doings. It's hard to contemplate. But it's I believe it's an important tenet of our belief that there is a plan. it might not be the way good the way you and I think about good. We should just open our minds to appreciate that our concept of what's good is not necessarily in line of what is good. It's a particularly powerful idea to reflect on as we're on the heels of Yom HaShoah. It's unimaginable on a collective scale, putting aside personal tragedies. It's unimaginable on a collective scale how we can ever be taken to the front of the tapestry and say, oh, the Holocaust, now I see how it was good. It boggles the mind. It boggles the mind. But I think it's okay to believe that there will be a time in history when we will understand how it was part of a plan. Part of a plan. It's beyond human conception. We know that this is one of the things that Moses asks God. After the Chet Egel, when God kind of is in a very merciful mode, so Moshe says, right, Hareini nas kavodacha, show me your glory, show me your ways, Hareini nas derachacha. And the rabbis explain that Moshe was asking this exact question, Tzadik viralo, Rasha v'tovalo. How come good things happen to bad people and bad things happen to good people? What was God's answer? Remember, what was God's answer? Lo yirani adam v'chai. Nobody can see me and live. Which the Rambam and others explain means that God is saying that our brains can't handle the information. It just can't. Lo yirani adam v'chai. So it doesn't mean that we don't believe it. It means that we acknowledge our limitations and we have questions. We don't have to dismiss the questions. We have real questions, real questions. But we can believe with full emuna that a time will come when those questions will be answered. How and when? It's beyond understanding, beyond. But I don't think it should stop us from believing that a time period exists where those questions will be answered. I don't think it's a tarte de sastre. It's not inherently contradictory. Yeah, Jeff.
Big picture, just at the beginning of the chapter in Schwab's book on Ashrei, it says Ashrei offers, this is like 30,000 feet.
Okay.
Ashrei offers us an opportunity to concentrate at least momentarily about whom and to whom we are talking before we engage in the Hallelujah Selah, in which the Tefillah Shachrit consists of recitation of the Tehillah of David with the last five chapters.
Right.
Of the hill.
Okay.
But it's a stopping off point to say, you know what? And then you can see.
Right.
Let's stop for a moment and let me remind you.
Right.
Daveners.
Right.
And then it's line.
Right. 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 This is a glimpse into a world that we can't fully appreciate. Ashrei speaks of a time when God's glory will be so clear for the world that all of our questions will be answered, and we're just going to sing out in praise. We can't imagine it. The questions are sometimes too deep, for us to even contemplate an answer. But
what did you think of earthquakes, hurricanes?
Okay, I'm not dismissing that. I'm not dismissing that. Yeah. But I think that when we say these words, it's a good opportunity to reinforce our emunah. Hashem, we believe that there will be that tapestry and we will see it and it will be magnificent. It doesn't mean, that we're going to understand it. It doesn't mean that everything will be, let me rephrase that. It doesn't mean that it will all be good the way you and I measure good. But it will be ordered. There's a plan to Jewish history and human destiny. And that's what we speak of in Ashrei. Yoducha Hashem kol ma'asecha. There will be a time where everybody will acknowledge this sort of order and kindness that we know is true. Yeah. The Baruch Shamar of Baruch Epstein, whose sefer I really enjoy learning, he just references a point he made earlier. In Baruch Shamar, we use this language, hamihulal and mishubach. And when we learned Baruch Shamar, we talked about this insight, that there are different levels of praise. There's praise that's accessible to the regular layman, and then there's something that people who are closer to God can appreciate even more. It's intuitive, right? People will praise God according to their level. And he just references that idea in our pasuk also, because we seem to have a two-tiered system. Yoducha Hashem kol ma'asecha. So we speak of yoducha, we speak of giving thanks. Who's giving the thanks? Kol ma'asecha, everybody. So there's some sort of universal thanks, acknowledgement, gratitude that everybody will be able to provide. But it's not the only level, because what comes next? Yivarchucha v'chasidecha yivarchucha. The chasidim, the pious ones, will bless you on an even higher level. So the Baruch Shamar just points out that we see a two-tiered system, both in terms of the language you use in Baruch Shamar, and also the language that we use in Ashrei. You have the thanks of the masses, and then people who are closer to God, more intimate, can appreciate things on an even deeper level.
And the more you study, the more you learn.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's intuitive that there are different levels of praise. So we're not going to read that inside. I'm just going to share with you one last verse, and then we'll conclude. The Pasuk in Tehillim, Yud Aleph, Kivod Machuscha Yomeru, they will tell the glory of your kingdom, U'gvurasecha Yidaberu, and they will speak of your might. So let's connect that to what we've been saying, and then we will conclude. So the Radak writes, Kavod, Be'osam HaBrachos, when we speak about the Chasidim Yivarchucha, when we speak of the pious ones giving praise, in that praise, Yaskiru Kavod Malchuscha V'gvurascha, they will speak of the honor of your kingdom and of your might. The truth is, in every bracha we make, Baruch Ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam. So Kivod Malchuscha Yomeru. When we speak of blessing, we will speak of your kingdom. Ki Ata Melech Al Hakol Uvorei Hakol. You're the king of all. You create all. Uvigurascha Uvicholscha Hayos Hayitzurim Kulam. And it's only through your might that we exist, and that we are able to operate. And that's really what the Malbim writes also in Source 17, Kivod Malchuscha Yomeru, V'achasidim Ha'ele Yomru Tamid Kivod Malchuscha. These pious ones, going off of the previous verse, the pious ones praise. When they praise, they speak of God's Malchus, which is very interesting. Look what the Malbim writes. What does Malchus represent? Shehu Sipur Ma'asav HaKivuim Kefi Hanhaga HaTivi'it Sheyisad Merishis Kidumim. What's Malchus? Kingdom refers to God in nature. God operating within the rules of the natural world that He set up from the very beginning. Shebezeh yanhig kemelech hanohig al pi chukei malchuso. Because this is like a king. Because a king sets up rules and regulations. What is our king, the kingdom of the universe? The king of the universe, what does he do? He sets up the laws of nature. Laws of nature. Right, one sort of beautiful idea, it's simple, but it's so profound, that the laws of nature are the most constant manifestation of the will of the Almighty. Think about it. The laws of nature, Jeff, you're listening? It's amazing. The laws of nature are the most constant manifestation of the will of the Almighty. The fact that my, you know, watch drops because of gravity is a manifestation of God's desire that things that are let go will drop down to the lowest point. So, Kivod Malchuscha, we'll speak of the honor of God's kingdom. That refers to the God through the natural world. Just like a king has rules, so too, the king of kings has rules. The Gam Gevuroscha Yidaberu, but they also speak of God's might. What does that refer to? Exactly, a God above nature. Who Mashiyase Hashem Osos Umofsim Umishadeid HaTeva. That's what God does above nature. So there's going to be a time when we speak of God in nature and God above nature. Shehein hein gevurosav. This is the strength of God. Vezos yidaberu pa'orech shezeh geder hadibor. And they're going to speak about it at the length. So kivod machuscha yomeru. They're going to speak of God in nature. Ugevurascha yidaberu. And they'll also speak of your might. Malchus teva gevura lemalem in hateva. So I hope this was interesting and instructive. We say these words every day, and we just kind of gloss over them. I think they're very, very powerful words, and they really speak of a time that is thrilling, that's exciting. It's hard to fully relate to, but it doesn't mean that we can't think about it as we say these prayers. Pei Yeshikolach, and Bezrat Hashem, we will continue next week, hopefully finishing up Ashrei. Skip to the Shema. And the Shmona Esrei. So hopefully.